Hello everyone, welcome to KTHME Learning Center. I am Shweta Nandakumar Burhade, Assistant Professor, Department of Botany, KTHM College, Nashik. Today we are going to learn about very interesting topic, which is ethnobotany, which is part of your certificate course in botany. So today we are going to discuss about role of ethnobotany, in which today's topic is role of ethnobotany in modern medicine. The learning objectives of today's lectures are to learn about the connection between herbal medicine, or we can say ethnobotany, folk medicine and modern medicine. So we are going to see the connections between these. So agenda of today's session is definition and concept of ethnobotany, which we are going to study basic ethnobotany very fast. Then we are going to understand the role of ethnobotany in modern medicine. So now let us discuss what is ethnobotany first. So there are multiple definitions out of which I have selected two over here. So ethnobotany is study of plants and their practical uses through the knowledge of people and through ancient history. So year by year, generation to generation, people are using natural remedies to cure their small diseases or to cure the small problems, health problems. So we are going to study all these medicine, natural remedies people are using generation to generation. So also ethnobotany is study of interrelations between humans and plants. However, the current use of term implies the study of traditional knowledge, indigenous knowledge of the plant. So what traditional knowledge we have, our elders, our ancestors, told us about the plants and their uses for different remedies, we are going to study that. So it involves indigenous knowledge of plant classification, cultivation and use as a food, medicine and shelter. So we are going to study it scientifically or botanically, the traditional knowledge. So this study is actually based on few terminologies, which is symbiosis. So like when two different organisms, they depend on each other, they help on each other and they work for their welfare, we call it as a symbiosis. So in symbiotic association of two different plants or two different organisms, they both are benefited from the association. So now in this particular case in ethnobotany, the example is human beings and plants. Okay, so humans and plants, they are in symbiotic relationship. They both benefit each other. Plant provides food, shelter and medicine also. But in today's perspective, we are going to discuss about the medicinal uses of plant. So we are dependent on plants and they are dependent on us for survival. This is, we call it as a coexistence or the symbiosis. So some people also call ethnobotany as a folk medicine or a tribe medicine. So tribal people or the ancient from the generation to generation, what ancestors we have, they use plant for herbal remedies. That is why we call it as a folk medicine or tribe medicine. So now what is modern medicine? So far you must have studied about the ethnobotany, what is ethnobotany, Ayurveda, Charak Samhita, etc. But now we are going to study the connection of those, what we can say, ancient knowledge and history to the modern medicine. So what happens when we use the herbal remedies or we use the Ayurvedic medicine, we don't have content, right? We don't know the constituents of that particular medicine. So for example, we have Tripura Churna, in which we have Amla. But we don't know how much quantity of vitamin C is present in particular that powder, right? So we don't know the accurate amount or accurate constituent in mg or grams, milligrams, etc. Like as we know that in allopathy, in the modern medicine, we know each and every constituents and its proportion in it. And those drugs are, they are purified. But these herbal drugs, we don't know the constituent first and they are not purified. So what happens is, we can't use them scientifically. So for that particular problem, what we are going to do is, we are going to connect this herbal medicine to make modern medicine or to make modern drugs. We are going to use their active principle. So to study the modern medicine, we have to go through the few definition or terminologies first, which is ethnopharmacology. Okay, so this is the modern terminology for using the ethnobotany in modern medicine. So ethnopharmacology, we can define it as a the interdisciplinary scientific exploration of biologically active agents that are traditionally used, employed or observed by man. Okay, so whatever herbal remedies we have, whatever natural medicine, Ayurvedic medicine, what we call as, so we are going to study it or explore it scientifically. We are going to study it scientifically, how this particular plant is used for this particular remedy. For example, why Adusa, why we use the decoction of leaf extract of Adusa, why we use that for the cough remedy only, what active principle it is having. Okay, so we are going to study that now. So first we are going to study the ethnopharmacology and bioprospecting. So first let us discuss what is bioprospecting. So bioprospecting is exploration of natural sources or biological sources for small molecules, macromolecules and biochemical and genetic information. So whatever naturally we have, we are going to prospect it, we are going to study it and how we can use that in the modern science. So the this bioprospecting in the view of ethnopharmacology or ethnobotany focuses on development of new drugs. So what happens nowadays, as you see, we have multiple antibiotics, antivirals, but bacteria and viruses on which we are using, they are getting immune to it. They are getting resistant to it day by day. Okay. So this is a need to find the new antibiotics to the new antiviral agent. So for this, we are going to study the different plants so that we can derive those new antibiotics or new form or new type of antibiotics, antiviral drugs for those these virus and bacteria are not resistant. So this is most important part. So how we are going to do is how we do bioprospecting. So first is what we do is we analyze it biochemically. Okay, we make powder, we study what kind of secondary metabolite, primary metabolite it is having, what kind of chemical it is having. Okay, we study the biological or we study the morphology of that particular plant. We study a pharmacological activity to development of drug templates, or we can say the new templates. So currently we have different pharma companies or different biotechnological companies which are screening lakhs of samples, literally more than 50 lakh samples to study and to have a different metabolite so that and against a single target. For a single target or for a single bacteria to work against that bacteria, they are studying more than 50 lakhs samples. So ethno-directed research. So we have studied pharmacology, right? We have studied bioprospecting. In pharmacology, what we study, active principles or medicinal properties of that particular plant in the modern approach, scientific approach, right? So ethno-directed research. So ethno-directed research as in whatever ancient knowledge we have, whatever our elders have told us about the particular plant remedies, we are going to research it. But this should be the proper research. So we have more than 3 lakhs higher plant species in the world, right? Angiospermic plant, we can say. So most of they are having few medicinal activities. So we are going to study very few for their therapeutic potential. So we have few approaches to study or to select the plant for pharmacological screening. We can't study all 3 lakhs plant, all active principles or all molecules they are having. So what we do is we select few plant. Okay, first what we do is select few plants. So there are a few approaches. The first one is random approach. Okay, so somebody told me that, okay, my great grandmother, or for example my great grandmother-in-law, she used a plant, Coxtus pictus, or insulin plant. She take the leaf and she boil it in her tea and she drinks. What she believes that this is insulin plant which will reduce her sugar. Okay, so for this was an example. So we have many examples like this that our elders told us that, okay, this we use this plant for this particular thing. So this is the random approach. Okay, I'll study that plant then. So next one is phytochemical targeting, which entails the collection of all members of that particular plant family. So for example, I observe in particular plant family, I observe that out of this family, 2 or 3 genera are medicinal. They are having the medicinal property. So I'll study all the members of those particular family thinking that, okay, all others must have few other secondary metabolite or other medicinal properties. Okay. So next is chemotaxonomic approach. So while classifying the plant, so when we categorize the plant, okay, all there are too many plants as we have seen. So when we categorize, when we classify the plant, we have that if we study the chemical analysis also. Okay, we analyze that plant chemically so that we can classify the, that plant. So even we can use this chemotaxonomic approach that, okay, this particular plant is having this secondary metabolite. That means we can use this plant for that particular remedy or that particular curement. Okay, So next approach is using specific part of plant, such as in few medicine we use seeds, in few medicine we use flowers like clove, we use flower, in few asparagus, shatavari, we use roots of that. Okay, so this is also an approach of the research. So next is we are going to study the active principle. This is very important, active principle. When we study modern science or when we study modern medicine, active principle is very important. So while studying the herbal medicine or the herbal remedy for the scientific study, we are going to study the active principle of that, what chemicals constitute or what molecule it is having which is providing that particular medicinal activity. Okay, so now we are going to study the active principle or the molecule which is behind that chemical activity. So let us define active principle first. Okay, it is a constituent of a drug. Okay, it is something, a part of drug, usually a secondary metabolite which is alkaloid or glycoside. Upon presence of which, the characteristic therapeutic action of the substance largely depends. Okay, so presence of this active principle, it is very important. So what active principle that particular plant or that particular plant extract or that drug is having, it is very important. So we are going to study that active principle, and then we are going to extract that particular secondary metabolite, and then we are going to use it for making the new medicine or modern medicine we can. So let us discuss what is secondary metabolite first. So there are two types of metabolites in plants, primary metabolites and secondary metabolites. So primary metabolites, they are the large macromolecules which are required in large quantity and they are very essential for growth of plant. For example, carbohydrates, proteins and lipids. Okay, they are very essential and they are mostly required in plant growth and development. If they are not there, plant won't grow and develop. And second type is secondary metabolites, which are non-essential metabolites, okay, which are having accessory duties in the plants. So what is definition of secondary metabolite? Secondary metabolites, also called as specialized metabolites, these are toxins, secondary product or natural products, and they are organic compounds produced by bacteria, fungi or plants. And their function is to defense. Okay, primary function is to defend the plant or bacteria or fungus, or they are having the additional duties in the plant. They don't have the primary duties, but generally they are involved in defense of plants from different insects, herbivores, etc., and also again different resistance against the stress and the diseases. So these are secondary metabolites which are active principle for us. Okay, so these secondary metabolites, we have different classes of secondary metabolites: terpenoids, alkaloids, glycosides, etc. So why plant is having? So for example, I'm giving you again, if we use adursa or adathoda vesica, which is for the cough, okay, we use the decoction for of it. So we use it for cough, but plant don't have cough. Okay, so why alkaloid is present or why the plant is having that particular activity? To defend themselves against the herbivore. Okay, so different goats or cows, they eat the plant, right? So defend themselves from this herbivory, what they do is they make the secondary metabolites so that they can defend themselves. But we use this activity for our welfare. Okay, we use this secondary metabolite for us, for our herbal remedy. So these are the active principles. So mainly active principles are this part of the secondary metabolites. So first class of secondary metabolite is terpenoids. Okay, these are major group of substance derived biosynthetically from isopentyl diphosphate. Okay, these are having a large class of natural products, and these are composed of isoprene units. They have different isoprene units. So they are only hydrocarbons. Terpenes are hydrocarbons, and hydrocarbons and oxygenated hydrocarbons. One type is hydrocarbon and second type is oxygenated hydrocarbon. The molecular formula of terpene is C5H8 and C5H8 bracket close N. N is number of the isoprene units. So example of terpenoids is very popular example is gibberellin. So what is gibberellin? Gibberellin is actually a plant hormone. Okay, what is gibberellin? It is a plant hormone which is involved in flowering of plant. Okay, next class of secondary metabolite in plants is phenolic compound. So these are also chemical compounds which are aromatic, and they are having aromatic ring structure, and they are bearing one or more hydroxyl groups. So phenolics are most abundant secondary metabolites in plants, and they are having very simple molecule to very complex molecule to polymerase structure, for example tannins. example of phenolics are tannins, and most famous example is flavonoid. You must have seen the advertise of green tea, right? So green tea is having flavonoids, and which reduces belly fats, etc. You have seen. There is no much scientific support for that, but these are flavonoids which are seen responsible for the lipid metabolism, but that doesn't mean that it will reduce your weight. Okay, so this flavonoids are a component of a tea. Next is alkaloids. So these are also diverse group of nitrogen containing basic compounds. They are typically derived from plant sources and contain one or more nitrogen atoms. Chemically, they are heterogeneous. They don't have any homogeneous structure. So based on chemical structure, they may be classified into two categories: non-heterocyclic or atypical alkaloids, which is colchicine and taxol. So you must know this colchicine, that we use this to prevent the formation of spindle fiber, so that we can observe the metaphase in the cell cycle or cell division. And taxol, yes, taxol is very famous alkaloid, which is used as an anti-cancer agent. Yes, this taxol is a secondary metabolite which is used for anti-cancer treatment. Next is heterocyclic or typical alkaloids, and there are very popular three examples are there. Quinine, they are used in different malarial and antimalarial treatments. Caffeine, which is part of your coffee, and nicotine, which is part of the nicotine, which is very harmful, as you all know. The next one is glucosinolates or glucosides. They include sulfur and nitrogen also, and they are found very less in compared to other classes. And the example is glucoraphanine from the broccoli. Okay, so role of the secondary metabolite in medicine. As far we have discussed before, the active principle, it is the secondary metabolite, right? So the plants is having the active principle, the secondary metabolite, which are we use for the remedies of different problems or different cures. Okay, so these secondary metabolites are very important in studies. So many drugs used in modern medicine are derived actually from the plant secondary metabolites, just modern medicine, right? So instead of, see, what we do in herbal medicine or in ethnobotany, we use the powder, direct powder, leaf powder, root powder, fruit powder, etc. But when we connect this herbal medicine, when we connect this ethnobotany or folk medicine to the modern medicine, what we do is we extract the particular compound or particular molecule that which is of our interest. Okay, so we know that this is the active principle, it is responsible for particular remedy. We just are going to purify that from the plant rather than using the powder form. Okay, so sometimes this is a new discovery now. So sometimes not directly plant is responsible for the herbal activity or the medicinal property. It is having endophytes. So what are endophytes? Endophytes are microorganisms. Okay, they are microorganisms, maybe actinomycetes, bacteria, fungus. They are using inside the plant. Okay, and they are not harming the plant, and they are making secondary metabolites inside the plant, which are used as which provide the medicinal activity to the plant. So example is vinca rosa. Now vinca rosa is Catharanthus, popularly known as sadafuli, we call it. So when they discover that sadafuli is having the anti-cancer activity, or vinca is having, Catharanthus is having anti-cancer activity, so they found that this anti-cancer activity showed diversity in diverse places. So if the Catharanthus I am having at the Trambakeshwar is not showing the medicinal activity, but at Igatpuri it is showing medicinal activity or anti-cancer activity, so why is it so? Then they observe that it is having few endophytes, or it is having few microorganism which is providing that medicinal activity to this. So this is also a new approach to the modern medicine. So what will happen now, instead of growing the whole plant, instead of cultivating the whole plant, wasting the land, what we can do is just isolate the endophytes out of that medicinal plant and culture it, and we can form the medicine out of it. This is very interesting discovery, and I'm working on it. Okay, so now we are going to study different examples of the ethnobotany connecting to the modern medicine. So we have four examples. The first and popular example is Artemisia annua. Okay, this is example of family Asteraceae, marigold, etc. You know the Tridex. This is family member of that particular family, Asteraceae. So Artemisia annua, it looks like this, and it is having high medicinal property. I'll show you what properties it is having. It is an anti-malarial drug. Okay, very interesting. It is anti-malarial drug. It is also called as a sweet wormwood. Okay, the common name is sweet wormwood, and it is used in China. Okay, so we also have herbal Chinese medicine, which is the effective remedy. So it is called as Qing Hao in Chinese. Okay, so over than 2000 years, so this particular plant Artemisia is used more than 2000 years in the China for treatment of fevers and chills. Okay, we get fevers and chills to treat that. Chinese people used to use the extract of this particular plant, but in 1972 they found the active principle in that. Okay, known what is active principle now, that when they have extracted that plant, when they studied that particular plant, so they got to know that there is one chemical or there is one compound element which is called as Artemisinin, which is responsible for this medicinal activity. Now they have separated it, right? Rather than using the powder of plant, they have separated that Artemisinin out of it, and they have made the more soluble derivative. Soluble inside the stomach. Okay. Now when we take the powder of particular plant, what it takes time to dissolve in the body, right? And it body have to extract whatever it want from that particular powder. But what we are doing in modern medicine is we are providing the actual active principle ready-made to the body. So it is easily dissoluble. So it will show effect very early than the powder one, right? Then after research and more research, they found a more soluble derivative such as Artemether, Artether, and Artemotil. Okay, this is discoveries of this recent year. So this drug or this active principle is used in combination. So don't think that, okay, I'll have the powder of this particular plant and malaria will be cured. No, it is not like that. You have to have the expert supervision for it. So this particular drug is used in combination, not only single, in combination with mefloquine, and have proved highly effective in treating malaria, and particularly the most deadly one, which is Plasmodium falciparum. Okay, Plasmodium falciparum causes malaria. So for this particular, it is very useful. And as I've already told you that these particular microorganisms, they are getting resistance day by day. They are getting immunity day by day against our medicine. But this Artemisinin is very good against it. So it is not getting easily immune by that particular product. And it is easy to find the different variants of it if that bacteria or if that microorganism is getting immune to it. Okay, so Artemisinin is also proved as an anti-cancer treatment. So it is not that vastly explored yet, but they think that it may be an anti-cancer treatment, and there is going on brief research on it. Okay, so World Health Organization, WHO, have given the, what we can say, boost to this particular production of Artemisinin. They have also studied it briefly, and they have also noted that, okay, this particular plant is having anti-malarial property, anti-malarial active principle. Cultivate it, multiply it, and boost the production so that we can cure it from the Asia. So next example is Rauwolfia serpentina, which is of the Apocynaceae family. So Apocynaceae family, again the Sadafoolii family, and it is the characteristic of this particular family is they are having the milky latex, sticky latex kind of thing. So it is very common. You can find this plant in Cretaceous campus area, anywhere, Rauwolfia serpentina. So Rauwolfia serpentina is popularly known as Sarpagandha. Okay, so this story behind the discovery is very interesting. So what happened is tribal people, they used to observe the mongoose. You know the mongoose, right? So after fighting with King Cobra, the mongoose still survives. So they used to wonder that how that mongoose is surviving even after getting bite from the cobra. So one day they followed that particular mongoose, and they saw this mongoose, he uprooted the Rauwolfia serpentina, Sarpagandha, and he ate the root of that particular plant. Okay, and this happened again and again. After fight, mongoose goes and eats the root of Sarpagandha. Then they got to know, okay, that means the root of Sarpagandha or root of Rauwolfia serpentina is having few medicinal properties. So we can use this to cure the snake bite or treatment of the snake bite. So as we have discussed, it is commonly known as Indian snake root or Sarpagandha. It is used for treatment of snake bite, poisoning, even for hypertension, mental illness, and tranquilizer to soothe. So somebody is having anxiety patient, someone gets hyper even in a minute, or he he or she feels that I'll have heart attack in within a minute. So to calm them, to soothe them, we use the tranquilizer. So is this Ravulfi also used as a tranquilizer? But it is not like you take the powder, grind it, and give it to the what we can say anesthesia patient. Even this needs the expert advice and expert supervision. So what we can say, it is having few active principles from which we can make this particular drugs. Okay, so it holds an important position in pharmaceutical world. Okay, why? Because having multiple alkaloids in the root. Okay, and they are having multiple uses, multiple alkaloids and multiple uses. Over 80 alkaloids are there, which are isolated from Ravulfia species. More than 80. In which reserpine, which is most important, right? Reserpine, which is used for the snake bite, which is most important and isolated in 1952. So after that, we have found multiple alkaloids in it, and they are having multiple uses for human being. Okay, now we have come to the summary of our lecture. What we have studied so far, we have studied the definition and basic concept of ethnobotany. We have studied what is active principle and what are secondary metabolites, so as to study the modern medicine and the connection between herbal medicine or ethnobotany and modern medicine. We have studied role of ethnobotany in modern medicine, and we have studied two examples. So now in next lecture, we are going to study two more examples of modern medicine and applications of this. So thank you so much. If you have any difficulties, any queries, you can find me at my email ID, KTHM email ID, shwetaburade@kthmcollege.ac.in, and even our Google Classroom for our certificate course, Ethnobotany. Thank you so much.